My name is Dunson Campbell. I'm the owner of this farm. It's located in Belvidere. It's 25 acres and it's part of the Belvidere farm. Belvidere was once the largest single producer of nutmeg estate in the world. I understand that from his historical notes. And we have gone through several changes. In the 90s, the government bought part of it and was distributed to farmers. There are several farms, over 300 acres, and the management practices of the different farms vary. But for this farm, we've decided to go to agroecological farming. And our story for this project here is meeting the challenges of climate change through organic practices. So what you would see here is are the practices that we are using on this farm to meet the challenges of climate change. And we can start by going through some of the challenges, right? The first thing that we try to do is to consolidate or to keep all of the practices that we thought were good practices, good agricultural practices, and build on them. So there was, in fact, an attempt by the previous owners to have a permaculture design here. We have taken that the previous owners, and we have strengthened it. For example, if you look around, you would notice that we have windbreaks covering right around this particular plot, what I call zone one, which is about 8 acres, zone one. It's windbreaks right around. And within the windbreaks, we have crops. We will come back to this, the crops, because this is one of the practice that we have actually placed here. We have to meet the challenge of climate change, plant stacking. And you would see the stacking as you move from here to another site. What we try to do is to mimic nature, in that we have agroecological farming. We try to get away from pure sand farming. When we bought the land, we bought the land on the condition that we would have gone into pure sand banana. And they've asked us to cut down the nutmeg trees and plant bananas. So most of us did that. Of course, we kept a few nutmeg trees, but not quite a lot. And in fact, my farm did not have many nutmeg trees. But so this, in fact, 15 years ago, if you stood here and look around, all you would have seen was just banana, pure stand banana. And we had tremendous problem. We gotten rid of that because we had the case of Moko disease, and then Black Sigatoka wiped out the whole thing. So now we are re-engineering the farm using the permaculture design and agroecological farming with organic farming. So we're mixing it all up, right? And this is what you see in our zone one. The zone two, we have just started to work on zone two. So you will see some elements where we are still clearing and replanting. So here in zone one, for instance, you will see we have the windbreaks, Blumahoe right around. Then we'll have nutmeg, we have citrus, we have banana, we have dashin, we have sorrel, we have avocado, all within that area here. So we try to move away from the pure sand to go to intercropping or agricultural farming. We've also in this area, because we are moving trees and moving things there, we try to control runoff, right? And soil water. So what we have done is to include swales, mini swales. And here we have right in front of us here, we have a mini swale. It's really a level drain along the contour that holds water for a particular period of time, right? When rain falls, this drain here fills up, right? And in 1 hour time after the downpour, the water infiltrates and go into the soil. So what we do, and we have a series of them here, right, that really captures the water and feeds the substrate. So you find the lens, the water lens that you have here are fed by these swales, so that in the dry season, or when it becomes very hot and the soil starts drying off, the topsoil, you have below, you have water, so that it the plants can stand up much longer to drought than if we didn't have these swales. The other thing is that if you notice the crops that we, when the rain falls, the rain can hardly get to this directly to the soil. It hits the leaves, and then it goes, it falls on the ground, right? And then we have all these different trees, what we call the plant stacking. Well, let me explain the plant stacking. Plant stacking really means that you have different levels of plant until you reach the ground. We're going to get closer to see, for example, the bloomahoe, the nutmeg, the citrus, the sorrel, the dashing, and tiniers right to the right, and it's not, and it's stacked in a way so that we try to protect the soil and have as many crops as possible. We're also trying to confuse the pest and disease. Well, stacking is a form of intercropping, right? So this is something that we practice on this farm, and the windbreaks and the protected agriculture. But we're not able to see the what we did, but we are experimenting on mini protective structure. We get very heavy rainfall during this time of the year, so what we have done, we do not have an example to show at this time, is to build some umbrellas, I call them, short umbrellas, so that we cover the soil with it about 3 feet from the ground. The rain falls on the plastic, does not go to the crop, falls into the drains on both sides, right, that we use as mini swale, and we have the crops growing, right, protected from the rain on those mini protective structures. So these are some of the practices that we have included in this story, right, on meeting the challenges through, we have, of course, we'll see in a little while, the biochar unit, and this is something new. It is made possible by the Global Environment Facility Small Grants Program, and what we're trying to do with this, instead of burning, right, and adding the carbon dioxide to the atmosphere, we're trying to reduce that and sequestrate the carbon in this in the char, so that we add it into the soil. Once we add the char to the soil, it does two things. One, it builds up, it holds nutrients. It provides a home for micronutrients in the soil, so that the plant can get its nutrient from that medium. And two, it sequestrates carbon. Yeah, so you have those two functions that the biochar does.
Tell us the main reasons or the main goals you had in getting into this kind of farming.
Well, I have gotten into organic farming, of course, from my connection with agriculture, and realized that agriculture, right, is both, as we said, it's the culprit, because agriculture is contributing a lot of carbon to the atmosphere, right? And it is also a victim of climate change, right? So I realized that organic farming, knowing a little bit about organic farming, I realized that the practices in organic farming can contribute to the mixture for meeting the challenges of climate changes. So that's why I am and in addition to this, you get safe and healthy foods coming out of organic production.
Okay. A little more detail in terms of the practices or the technologies or whatever it is you have implemented.
Okay, here we are on the to show the stacking that is being done on this farm. And I would start with the highest level, which is the bloomahoe, which is the windbreak. And of course, we know the function of a windbreak. It prevents the wind from destroying the crops, and of course, removing the flowers from the plants. And you notice from the windbreak, the tall part, then we go down to the nutmeg, which is the second level, right? The level, and then from the nutmeg, we go to the citrus, then we go to the bananas, then we come right down to the avocado. After bananas, we have the tiny, that is. So in this area here, we have bloomahoe, we have nutmegs, We have citrus, we have avocado, tanya, stacked together, and in a manner that you prevent the rain from falling on the ground. The fact that the soil is not exposed, once the soil is not exposed and it's not being broken down, when you break down the soil in plowing or you allow the rain to break up the structure, carbon is released. What you have in this particular situation, the release of carbon is reduced to a minimum. And you would notice that on the farm, that we also practice minimum tillage. We don't till the soil, right? We farm by just digging holes and planting. And we do not, farming using organic practices, you will notice that there are lots of weeds here, right? We do not use weedicide, period, right? So what we'll come in now, we'll come in with a weed eater, and we will cut the weeds, and the weeds will form a mulch. Again, that will cover the ground. So the ground, or the soil here is always covered. It's always covered. And what I've noticed by the using of those practices is that the water which gets out of my farm is much cleaner now than it used to before. Before, you could have seen the muddy water coming from my farm whenever rain falls. Now when you see it, it's, you know, it just runoff, you know, and it's not very dirty. So I know that I am protecting my soil, and I know that it is working.
So what motivated you to use these practices and the technology, like the biochar and so on?
Well, of course, I got convinced that organic agriculture, over my professional life, that organic agriculture is the way to go, right? It protects the soil, it gives you a product that is healthier and safer, and it also protects the ecosystem, right? Because you have, for instance, on my farm, you have birds and insects and everything just come around, and everyone seems to coexist.
Right.
So that there isn't this need to use pesticide and chemical and because nutmeg, the pests that affect nutmeg is not the pests that affect banana, that's citrus and so on. So the pests are confused. They cannot live and build up by the millions, right? You have a few of them here and there, right? But you do not have a system like we had, for example, when the whole 25 acres was bananas, right? So it allowed, for example, the borer and the nematodes to build up quite easily, right? But now, the nematode that affects banana, right, might be controlled by an exudate from dashin or from tanya, right? So you have this interaction that takes place in the soil that reduces the need for chemicals. Yeah, there's a balance. Yeah.
So what tools or inputs did you use to implement what you're doing?
My weed eater is extremely important. And we still use the machete to do some pruning now and then, I mean, right? But the weed eater, to me, without weed eaters, I cannot farm. Right. Right.
And where did you learn, you know, or where did you get the knowledge from to use this kind of practice or technology?
Well, I am by profession an agricultural extensionist. And I worked with the university for 25 years, so we're the center of knowledge. So I came from the center of knowledge, and I been charged to disseminate knowledge. So from my interaction with farmers, my interaction with the university and other professionals, I now have a body of knowledge that I can use for myself and for others.
Right, and how many other persons are exposed to this? How many people are using this?
Oh, well, our group is a small group. It's a 16 of us. But we interact with several groups, the farmers of the north, the Closure Young Farmers Cooperative, the NIFO Farmers Cooperative, the Grenrob Farmers are all part of the movement, right? So within the organization, if you have, let's say, five or six persons within NIFO who wants to go organic, can link with us because it's a movement, right? And so how many farmers? I really cannot give you a number. But it's growing. More and more people are now calling me. They want to, go into organic farming. Organic farming as a commercial venture in Grenada is not there as yet, but it has tremendous potential as a commercial. For example, our two major crops, cocoa and nutmeg, can be converted within a very short time to organic. But I guess they need someone to push them or to drive them towards right. that.
Right. In terms of the persons, what percentage you may say are women? Or are there any women involved?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, when it reflects the farming structure in Grenada. You know, I would say around 45, well, in vegetable farming, there are more women than men. But in tree crop farming, there are more men than women. So it depends on which system you have. You would find that the gender allocation is a little bit different depending on the type of farming.
Right. I guess yeah. you've been doing this for a while, right?
Yes, we've been farming or trying to farm since after Ivan, we moved into organic farming. So it is from, you know.
What kind of benefits have you been seeing, both in terms of the impact on the soil and in terms of the social impact?
Well, I explained to you already the benefit of the soil. Right, and I'm now start getting the benefits from that's the health part. The economic part is that I am using less synthetic fertilizer because now my farm is maturing. As my farm mature, I would need less and less synthetic fertilizer and more organic material to provide the fertility to my plants.
What would you say are the primary benefits of this system? Of farming?
The primary benefits of an organic system is really the food, safe food, right? Safe, healthy food, and from that production system, we maintain biodiversity again, and water system. We purify water system in most cases, right? So water system for the community, and the links between this agriculture and the marine environment, again, it is much stronger because we are not polluting the marine environment.
Right.
So we have these synergies that we can call upon.
And how would you say the practices you're using contribute to achieving the three main pillars of climate smart agriculture?
Well, in terms of the pillars, adaptation, improving, and the reduction of greenhouse gases. Well, of course, reduction of greenhouse gases, we are not burning, right? We are not burning. If we look, for instance, what we're trying to do later on with our biochar unit, this is a mechanism to reduce the burning so that you have emissions of carbon dioxide. We're trying to stabilize the soil, right? So that we have soil erosion, right? Would be reduced, right? And you have a cleaner water system coming out of, and of course, healthier foods.
What about in terms of resilience to the climatic conditions?
Of course it is resilience because our plants, for example, you saw a while ago the swale, our plant would stand up longer in a drought than other plants because we have water, we store water, right? We in fact, one of the things that we use in the principle that we use in organic, we call it the 5S, right? We slow water, right? Slowing water means it falls and it doesn't run off quick. It goes into a swale. We store the water. We store the water in the swale, right? For a little while so that it doesn't run off. We sink the water so the water goes into the soil, right? We share the water around, right? By getting the water to run off in thing, or by pumping it into our fields, and then we share it, right?
Can you quantify or say exactly who benefited from the introduction of these?
Well, of course.
Who are benefiting from the introduction of these practices?
I am benefiting. My family is benefiting. The people who buy my produce benefit because they get better produce, right? And the community is benefiting because I'm not polluting the environment, right? And the nation is benefiting, and the environment, the ecosystem is benefiting, because now we are bringing back the system of agroecological farming, where you can see the birds, you know, the lizards, the snakes, the manuku, the tatu, and all these things now find a natural habitat. So there is a habitat for nearly everyone now, right?
What is the potential for upscaling this operation?
Well, First, I have to upscale it on my farm. My farm is 25 acres. As I said, it's about 9 of it that I'm trying to first bring to organic. The others, it's moving slowly. I'm trying to convert it slowly. A question of finance, a question of labor to move into that system. I'm also trying to encourage bigger systems like the cocoa and nutmeg farmers or association, the cocoa and nutmeg association, to think organic. And to bring the system organic, because one, it's the farmers would benefit a little more because the organic will pay more, and two, you protect the environment. Right. You protect the environment. Yeah.
What would you say is left to be done on your farm, or do you think that you have reached a satisfactory level?
No. I have about 3 zones, and I have to work on zone 2 and zone 3 to get it to where it's supposed to be. Yeah, but we are going slow. As I said, we are limited by finance and labor.
Okay.
The most significant benefit for me is that I do not have to be purchasing a lot of pesticides and chemicals to control pest and disease. I mean, I remember when I was producing banana on Pewston, I used to use so much Furidone and you know, chemical to control borer and to control all sorts of things in the soil. Now I can produce my bananas without it. I can produce my bananas without it. So, and that, and most of that chemical remains in the soil or gets into the waterway, and you bathe in it, you drink it, you know.
How would you say the practices have made your farm more resilient to the impact of climate change over the long period?
Well, it's resilient to climate change because we talk about water already. Drought is resistant. It's more resistant to drought. It's more resistant to strong winds because you notice my area is really protected by windbreaks. So you have windbreaks right around. And in addition, you have trees. So, for example, the citrus would protect the nutmeg. Right, and because they are stacked, for example, the bigger trees will protect those below, and it goes right onto the ground.
Right.
So, should in case we get a very strong
hurricane
or something, yes, we're going to get some damage, but it would not be as bad as if we just had one crop, you know.
Did you encounter any unforeseen challenges when you were implementing these measures? Or were there anything?
Well, we always know that it would be difficult, even for my workers, to accept the fact that we can produce things without, we can produce a commodity without much, fertilizer and pesticide. So there are skeptics, right? And we are changing them slowly, but it will take a little while.
Right.
Take a little while.
What are the lessons you learned through implementing these practices?
First, the first and most important lesson is that organic farming can work. And organic farming, unlike what most people believe, you know, that production would fall and you would not be able to make a profit, I am not seeing that. I'm seeing my plants producing as much as when I had, synthetic chemicals, right? Of course, I realized that when I started, right, the production fell. Right, and because Grenada does not pay you more for organic produce, it was a big financial strain. It was so strong a financial strain that at one time I said, "I think this is a wrong project. I should get out of it." But then my friends in Jamaica, especially in Jamaica, who come to my side now and then when I have technical problems, they say, "Don't stick it out. We all have to go through that." And now I'm at the stage, I am not fully organic as yet. I'm not fully organic as yet, but I am on the path, especially this zone 1, right? In zone 2, I still use a lot of synthetic fertilizer, right? Because I don't have the compost, right? I don't have the material for that section yet. But in all my fields, in all 25 acres, I have decided absolutely not to use glyphosate, gramoxone, any weedicide at all, no, right? So you would come on my farm, like now you would see like bush and so on, it's all right, leave it there. We're going to cut it, we're going to be mulch, and so that part, I am convinced. Now the next part is to find the organic material, right, to help with the soil fertility.
What would you say were the key factors to meeting the objectives of adapting to climate change and enhancing productivity and, of course, income?
Well, of course, you need to, as I said, stick to it. For instance, during the first years of conversion, you would notice a fall in production. But this is normal. If you do not understand that process, you will give up from that point, right? Mm-hmm. But beyond that, you start seeing things happening. I mean, remarkable. You know, you will see, for example, this little avocado tree is bearing between tinier and so on, and look at spotless leaves, right? If you had grown it somewhere else, you would have seen all kind of insects and so boring holes and so on. Look at this, spotless. And then the nutmeg and everything, you know. So the intercropping, I'm seeing the benefit of intercropping. I'm seeing the benefit of stacking, right? And one of the things that we said in banana gives you a regular stream of income. Intercropping does the same thing, right? Because the nutmeg comes in at one time, the citrus comes in at one time, the banana comes in at one time, the dashing and the tiny comes in at one time. So you always have something to harvest, right? A flow of income, right? And this is extremely important for someone converting to organic farming.
What are your major challenges right now in terms of expanding or scaling up to these?
Finance and labor. Because the cash flow is not, I don't have a strong cash flow. Because the price of commodity, what I get for my commodity is not a just price. It's not a just price. In fact, I make so much trouble with my buyers because I'm giving you a commodity that is healthier than the others, but yet still I get the same price.
Right.
So that is, to me, is something that I am concerned about that. I'm really, really concerned about, you know, the fact that I'm not being treated fair. I'm not being encouraged to do that practice.
Right.
But I'm still going to be on it.
What are your conclusions in terms of these practices, these climate smart agriculture?
Start small. Do not attempt to go big, right? And it should be in sort of a concentric circles. Grow for your home, right? Make sure that your home is well fed with organic thing. The surplus, you sell it to your neighbors, right? And as you get better, you sell it to the supermarkets and so on. And you get dedicated household. And you build a system, right? That, I would say, is the way to go. Right?
What would you say to the skeptics, those who are really not convinced that this is the way to go?
Well, the only how you can convince the skeptics is by demonstrating. And we've decided to demonstrate that we can produce commodities without these chemicals, right? And we can make some money.
Right.
Here we are by our biochar unit. And I have on the side of Leslie Roach. He is our technologist and the builder of the unit. We put our heads together, got our information from the International Biochar Initiative Group, and we decided to design a system for the burning of biomass without much emission of CO2 in the atmosphere. So this unit reduces the emission of CO2 through controlled burning.
Right.
It also produces a char, what locally you call charcoal. But for us, the char that is produced in this unit is different from the charcoal we know. This unit converts the biomass into char using a temperature of 700 degrees Fahrenheit. Whereas our local coal pit or coal kiln, it burns the same biomass at 400 degrees. So there is much higher temperature in this. And what the higher temperature does is to remove the oils and the raisins from the wood. So when you get this char at the end, you get it a pure form of carbon. But this is step one. Now you can use that pure form of carbon and cook if you want to, but this is not our objective. We use that, we crush that char, right, into like a fine powder, and we mix it with compost. We call that the charging of the compost, and then we apply it to the soil so that the carbon remains in the soil for years, right? And what it does with the compost is to provide a home for soil microorganisms, so they live there and they exudate the chemicals that and the that are necessary for the plant, for plant growth. In the first few minutes of burning, you do get a little bit of smoke. Afterwards, it's steam. Because it's really two tanks, tank one and tank two. Tank two is where we load the biomass for conversion into carbon, right? So we place the tank two inside of tank one, right? We load it up. We load it up and then we cover it, right? So all of what is inside here would be used for making char. On the outside of tank two, we put dry material, right? And that dry material is used for burning. So it burns, it starts to build up the temperature. And when the temperature rises to about 400-500 degrees Fahrenheit, that temperature causes the heat inside to and the gas that's being released to burn. So you have now not biomass that is being burnt, but the gas. So you have pyrolysis on the outside, the burning on the outside,
right.
And on the inside you have gasification. So gasification would be inside of this. There is no fire inside of this. It's just gases that are burning, right? That the temperature has is risen to 700 degrees, so that the wood then change or gives up all the raisins and everything like that. So on the outside, the wood on the outside, you get ash. Those in tank two, you get char. So this is our biochar unit. And we have some footage of it. And our technologist, Leslie Roach, is the one. He has from the internet and from the International Biochar Initiative have put together the information. We had to get to this correct stage by, of course, making some mistakes. And again, Leslie Roach did correct it, right? And Leslie may want to tell you what we did to actually correct some of the challenges we had in coming to this
stage. Yeah, let's hear from you, Leslie.
Yes, we found that when we started the first time, the metal couldn't take it at the top. It was twisting up. So we had to add this steel, right or wrong?
Right, to brace it.
Yes, to brace it. And we had to put this angle iron at the end as well.
At the corners,
instead of the metal, yes. To make it stronger, so that when it goes down here, the cover would not have so much space on the side, so that the gas will come out.
It could be tight, right.
You have to keep it tight.
Right,
and
that
was most of, and the other problem is the amount of holes at the bottom. For this suck enough air, you have to pull air up, send it out to the chimney. If you don't have enough holes, you wouldn't get enough fire inside, so it wouldn't reach the temperature
for the other one inside
the start.
It wouldn't burn well.
Yes, so we had all these little problems, and then we correct them by adding more holes, checking it out. We had to burn a lot of times before we could get to the real thing.
Right.
Yeah, but right now it's okay.
Basically, we are addressing the pillars of reduction of carbon emissions by going through the biochar process.
And why did you enter this Climate Smart Agriculture regional competition, and what do you think your chances are of succeeding?
Well, I entered the competition, well, not really for the competition per se, but because we know we have something to tell others, and we want others to know that we're doing it, right? So I feel that if I tell my story, somebody will say, yes, we are doing something like that, but differently to what you are doing, right? And there we have what we call the building of our knowledge based on practices that right. are indigenous practices that are working in the Caribbean. So I entered it to share my knowledge, to gain knowledge, right? And of course, if we win, it's a feather in our cap. And we would say, bravo, you know, GOM has done something. We are a young organization, and we need these kind of exposure at this stage of our development, so that we'll grow from strength to strength. So yes, I would enter another competition like that just to show what we're doing.
Right.
And I would like feedback from the judges to say, well, listen, we think what you're doing is good, or we think that you can strengthen this, or we think you need to revisit this because it may not give you as much impact as you think you're getting, you know. So if I get that type of feedback, it is much better than having a prize. You get a prize, you go home, you put it on your way, you say, oh yeah, I get the medal, whoa, and then you throw the medal.
Right.
But when we learn something, we're there. Lifelong learning. That is, and it's basically what I refer to as livelihood learning. We know that we can do that because it, you know, we can pass it on
right.
from generation to generation.
Just thank you now.
Dr. Campbell, thank you very much for your time and all that you've shared.
Well, I'd like to say thanks, and before I leave, I want to say that this biochar unit was sponsored by Global Environment Facility Small Grants Program, and we're very thankful for their assistance. We're looking forward to get some more grant for them to do the next stage, version 2, we call it, right? And I want to thank AICA. I want to thank the Ministry of Agriculture people who supported me in getting the project through. And of course, my workers, my technologist who is here. Mm-hmm. And without my technologist, we would not be going very, very far. So thanks to everyone.
This is your farm.
Yes, this is my husband and my farm.
Right, so it's time that we heard from you.
We don't have the biochar yet, but we do have the compost. We're hoping to get...
Come across it.
We're hoping also to get a biochar unit. Also biogas. You know, we're hoping to actually get everything that is possible in terms of eliminating greenhouse gases and being self-sufficient on the farm. So... we definitely are eager to implement all of these practices.
Right. And you've started this how long now?
4 years. 2 years here full-time. We originally from the United States. We started with some soursops that the government, you know, promoting soursop from Grenada. And that was, 4 years ago?
4 years ago. In terms of, it was being given out free through a United Nations project to prevent soil erosion. Mm-hmm. And it became economically viable. So, you know, it's all part of the same thing.
Yeah.
You know, soil erosion and the effects it has on soil, maintaining soil and things
so
like that.
Yeah,
it was a program of the Grenada Federation of Agriculture and Fisheries Organization,
yes.
GAFO.
Yes. So that's how we started 4 years ago. We were still living in New York. But about 2 years ago, we came down full-time, and this is our full-time job.
Okay. And I guess you're having a good time.
Yes, definitely.
What benefits have you begun to see already?
I've lost 10 pounds without trying. Which is a good thing, because I want to live long, and I never see fat people who live long. We just eat better. We eat, you know, everything that's on the farm. Primarily, except for, you know, maybe sugar and salt and very little rice, because we eat a lot of provision, a lot of root crops, you know, yam, sweet potatoes, dasheen, tanya, you know, we've really started to grow a lot of root crops, so we eat a lot better. And the air is fabulous down here, good weather, can't complain.
You're planting some
lemongrass, yes, to hold up the bank, and we've got some special pineapples, which we also planted, that have no pickers. So we're trying to beautify it a little bit.
Okay, so what's the purpose of this, though? It's just to hold up
the lemongrass.
Soil.
Yes, that's half of the purpose.
Yeah.
The other part is we can have tea. You can cook with it. You know, it's multi-purpose. But the main purpose is for us to hold up the bank.
All right. So you mentioned that you came originally from the States,
yes.
And then you got into farming. What is your motivation?
Well, this farm was my husband's farm originally. It was actually many more acres than over a period of time, because my husband's father inherited when he was really young. And he really wasn't interested in farming, so he had left it up to his sister to really take care of. That's the branches. And over the years, pieces were sold off, and this is what was left. And it was left to my husband, Carl. When we decided you know, we're getting up in age and we didn't want to be in the cold anymore, we decided, well, we're going to come down and do organic farming, and because we wanted to control what we eat, we wanted a different quality of life. We didn't want to be where there's snow anymore and the hustle and bustle of the States. We can always go back up, but we wanted a different kind of life in our older years. And also we wanted the opportunity to really work into our older years instead of just retiring and sit. And we saw the farm could do that for us. So that's basically the history. My husband started to come more often throughout the years, once he acquired, you know, the title and everything of the farm. And then 2 years ago, we literally came and, you know, 100% we're here.
Right. Yeah. Right. So describe in detail for us the things you have introduced as part of your organic farming and climate smart agriculture.
Well, composting and mulching, I think, are the main things. We don't use any pesticides. We do use some organic sprays, like for example on the soursop we use a golden pest spray oil, but anything that we use we try to be organic. We're not 100% organic yet, but and we're looking to start composting. As you can see, the compost bins are here, so we're hoping this month we'll actually start composting. And we know that's you can't be organic without composting and mulching.
Were there any unforeseen challenges in doing all this?
We knew it would be a slow process the first couple of years. You know, when you're doing what we're doing, where we're loading up the farm with lots of spices and things that weren't on the land, so we're purchasing every year. We're purchasing a lot of plants, avocados. We only had one avocado on the land. You know, we have over 40 now. So every fruit and vegetable, we want this farm to have everything, that every fruit and vegetable that exists in Grenada, we want to have here.
What are some of the main lessons you have learned in the process?
It's hard work. We're up at 3 o'clock in the morning. We're usually on the farm by 6, and we tend to leave here between 3 and 4. And you have to enjoy it. I think that's the key.
What are some of the things you would say are the key areas for meeting the objectives of adapting to climate smart agriculture, to climate change?
Well, I think the composting, I know we want to do, as Dr. Campbell said, the biochar. We actually just won another grant for biogas. We're looking at putting in some pig pens to feed the biogas, because that's another lot of work that you've got to do to actually feed the biogas. The biogas is something that you have to feed 220 pounds every day to. So I think what we're trying to do is utilize all of the natural resources that we have on the farm, so that we could try to meet the climate change issues that are on hand.
Okay, this is our compost unit that has been donated to this project, to this site, by ICAS, Integrated Climate Change Adaptation Strategy. Now, how it works, the compost unit has 5 chambers. The first 2 chambers, chamber 1 and 2, we use as our collecting bins, where we collect what we call the greens, which is the nitrogen-containing material, and the browns, which would be the carbon in that mix. So we have the green, we have the brown, and we build it up, right, until we are ready to do the mixing. When we have enough of green and brown that we think that we're ready for mixing, we move to this one, chamber 3. We mix in chamber 3, our first mix. That mix will put them, the browns, the green, on layers. So you'd have different layers coming up. to about 3 feet or 4 feet in here. 3 feet, or it could go to 4 feet, right? But we'll try to keep it within the 3 feet, right? And it's there. After 15 days, we will mix up the green and the brown together here once. And the second time we mix it, we're going to bring it here. So this is month one. This here, we do the same thing. We have the mix here. But already we would have a mix that has green and brown together. So we keep it like this, and then we mix it again because it would build up temperature, and we try not to allow it the high temperature to destroy the nutrients in there. So we mix it up. And then we go to the final bin here. We keep it here again for 1 month. We mix it up. And by the end of that third month, you would have compost ready to go. Well, this is the operation of the shredder. What we are seeing now is the shredded material of both the stem, the twigs, and the leaves. And we just apply it to the soil as a cover, right? We advise that you can do that before. In other words, shred the material. You can leave it in a heap to quail or to compost on its own before applying it. Because when you apply green material to the soil like this, the first thing that happens is that the green material takes away the nitrogen from the soil. So its first impact is to remove nitrogen and then add it later on. So farmers need to know that.
My name is Carl Duncan.
And what do you do on this farm? What do you do on this farm?
I work for my wife. No, well, we are trying together to do something productive in terms of sustainability, you know, and a quality product. We are very aware of good health and the availability of health care, and good food is a preventive in terms of health care. But I was also thinking about the chemical runoffs from some of the conventional farms and the impacts on reefs and mangroves and things like that, which are integral to the whole effects of climate change, you know. And even like a reef just outside there, which is protecting Grenville, if we kill that reef with all these chemical runoffs, you know. I'm always proud to look on my land. I know what to see a batty mamsel is. Mm-hmm. They talk about mosquitoes. They kill all the mosquitoes with spray. But we have batty mamsel here, which eat all the larva. I see butterflies. I see chicken hawks, you know. So this tells me that this is a healthy farm, you know. Some of these organic practices were in place long before we even came here. One of the examples you mentioned was the use of windbreaks. You know, some of the farmers, you know, you put it there, it prevents the heavy winds coming up from destroying plants. We have a lot of sauce up initially, but that's higher up the road where we planted as part of the UN previously mentioned UN project to prevent soil erosion.
Okay.
So we have, and that has turned out to be a very good cash crop.
We're at a location where Albucan will eventually be. This is a hole. Temporarily, we're using it to collect water during the rainy season, and then in the dry season, we put a pump in and we use it for our cash crops. So this is utilizing, yes, our rainfall in the wet season for the dry season. What we've done is, this was an area that had a lot of grass, and we do a lot of sorrel for Christmas. So what we did was we cleared it, we put down cardboard, and also the grass that was right from here that was cleaned up for mulching and keeping the weeds down.
Dr. Campbell mentioned about the historic use of agricultural practice, of organic practice. And up until recently, I was having a lot of guys who really had no idea, until I found these two gentlemen, Nestor and Wilbert. His name is Chiwa, more custom Chiwa. But they've introduced the idea of intercropping, like in between the soursop, and so we can find other valuable crops like corn. You may see some cassava down the line that we've planted in between it, beans, that could provide additional income. In the meantime, it keeps the grass down And, you know, it's some of the beneficial uses of intercropping that we've started to implement.
What are the greatest challenges you face right now, the current ones?
Probably finance. Because all the things that we're doing, although we're getting assistance with, you still have to put out a lot of money. So in the beginning, it is you do have to put out a lot more in the beginning than what you're going to get out of it. But we know in the long term, it's all going to work out.
I mean, that's basically your conclusion after you've started doing this, or?
Oh, it's worth it. It's definitely worth it.